because stress happens to everyone and we need to find ways and means to de-stress. You can take a walk, you can have a positive mindset, and always know that your temperament has a different way of coming up with how you deal with your stress. So thank you very much. This has been Health Africa. Hope to see you next week.
The Association of African Universities, AAU, is an international non-governmental organization set up by universities in Africa to promote cooperation among themselves and the international academic community.
Mon nom est Professeur Étienne Ewan Eile. Je suis le secrétaire général de l'Association des universités africaines qui est basée à Accra, au Ghana. Je vais vous parler de la création de l'Association des universités africaine. Il faut remonter dans les années 60 pour pouvoir comprendre le processus. Déjà en 1960, nos dirigeants estimaient que l'éducation est l'outil majeur pour pouvoir lutter contre la pauvreté et assurer le développement.
I am not Dumo Dlamini. I'm the Director of ICT Services and Knowledge Management at the Association of African Universities. The Association of African Universities is a network of 400 universities in Africa. The biggest value that the universities benefit from being members of the association is this big platform that allows them to collaborate, allows them to work together, allows them to teach together. Through this platform, a university in North Africa can work with a university in Southern Africa, and also those in East Africa can work with those in West Africa.
Founded November 1967 at a conference in Rabat, Morocco, by heads of African higher education institutions, the association is currently headquartered in Accra, Ghana.
My name is Maxwell Amohoit. I'm the Director of Finance of the Association of African Universities. The association sustains itself from contributions from member universities and also from other development partners. Some of our development partners include the World Bank, other governmental agencies like the Swedish International Development Agency, UK Department for International Development, and other partners. We also receive a lot of support from other governments, especially the government of Ghana. Other partners include the African Union, which is more or less the parent organization of the Association of African Universities. The Association of African Universities hosts the Secretariat for the African Union's Continental Education Strategy. And by so doing, we provide coordinating roles for the African Union in helping members achieve their targets.
Déjà en 1960, nos dirigeants estimaient que l'éducation est l'outil majeur pour pouvoir lutter contre la pauvreté et assurer le développement. Et rappelons-nous que les années 60, la décade 60, a été une décade où la plupart des pays africains ont obtenu leur indépendance ou ont, pris les dispositions pour être indépendants. C'était donc aussi l'année de développement, dans la mesure où tous ces pays indépendants devaient se retrouver de temps en temps pour parler de comment mettre ensemble leurs problèmes et trouver une solution commune à leurs problèmes. Et dans ce contexte-là, l'éducation était une priorité pour eux. Surtout l'éducation universitaire. Et sur ce plan-là, les universités aussi se sont organisées grâce à à l'UNESCO, qui a parrainé plusieurs réunions depuis Madagascar jusqu'au Maroc.
My name is Jonathan Mba. I'm the director of research and academic planning. The programs and projects that we run at AAU are consistent with our strategic plan, and they are implemented for our higher education stakeholders, namely the higher education institutions in Africa. These programs are implemented in such a way that our stakeholders will get the benefit of membership of our association. And our programs also are aligned with a number of global and international agendas on higher education, including the Continental Education Strategy for Africa and Agenda 2063. So these programs are aligned with a number of international agendas with a view to promoting higher education in Africa.
The AAU is the apex organization and principal forum for consultation, exchange of information, and cooperation among universities in Africa.
I am Professor Nkosi Mahau, Vice Chancellor of the National University of Lesotho in the Kingdom of Lesotho in Southern Africa. There are roughly 77 universities that are affiliated with the AAU in the region. But as you might be aware, there are a lot more universities that are as yet to take the membership of the Association of African Universities. Well, universities that are not members of the AAU are missing quite a lot. First of all, let's appreciate this one point, that the AAU is a main driver from the angle of training and capacitating the human resources of the continent, the agenda of the African Union 2063. So if an institution is not on board, it is missing the opportunity to leverage on the opportunities that are provided by the association in the area of training human resource capital, training their own staff and students, the opportunities that are provided by the universalization of quality management on higher education on the continent, and many other opportunities that are provided.
Et en 1963, il y a eu une réunion à Khartoum, au Soudan, où les chefs des institutions d'enseignement supérieur ont décidé de créer l'Association des universités africaines. Finalement, la création va se faire à une conférence qui s'est tenue à Rabat, au Maroc, et la création de l'Association des universités africaines a eu lieu le 12 novembre 1967.
I'm Prof. Hassan Kafi, AAU governing board member, representing for East African region. Also, I am the president of Plasma University, Mogadishu, Somalia. We really like to give a call for universities in Africa, especially in East Africa, those which are not members still in the Association of African Universities. We are calling them because we feel the organization is ours. It represents the voice of higher education in Africa being seen all over the world.
this is our pedal journey. This is a sociology, social work, anthropology, social policy, social administration group. And we are in a moving train. So that's our pedal journey. And the name of our train is Krabala. Accra, Ibadan, Kampala. Yes. Sorry. Lorry train. Lorry. No. It's just Accra, Ibadan, and Kampala. Yes. And we are moving from Nairobi into the future. So you can see our stops. So based on our stories, based on the stories we put together, our group appears to have focused. Our goal was on innovative learning approaches. And from what we have, we used mainly the youth learner-centered approaches and technology and technology for teaching. So we have the role play, and we had very, very innovative ideas where some of our colleagues used kits, drama in class, got some of the students to buy a concept and dramatize the concept so their colleagues will know, will learn. We also had case teaching. We got cases from the MRPP, the Arab Spring, to teach social mobilization theories. There was also the use of concept mapping. There was the use of storytelling, using the story of Joseph in the Bible. And because the students could relate, it was a blast. The students had a very nice time in class. We also had a project approach where students were sent on a project, go into the field, go and explore issues about topics that are going to be taught in the semester. And then anytime the topic was being taught, students were able to relate with what was going on in the field. We also had the use of simulation, where one of our colleagues used Monopoly to teach negotiation strategies. We found that very, very interesting and innovative. There was peer assessments. There was experiments where students were sent into the field as part of their lecture in social psychology and conducting field work to go into the field and pose as many things, including practicing juju or being a fraud in the night, wearing hoods too, just to see how the public will respond to things like that. And then there was also the Google Classroom, which our colleague tells us that has cut down costs and the students are enjoying it very much. He's able to engage all his students at the same time or at different times, and he knows who is contributing and who is not contributing. So I will talk about, we don't have a chat like you see it, but our train is a chat. So, as you can see, our strategies, this is innovation, when trains become charts, you know. So our, so our strategies is a double deck train, you know, just that part has the double deck, and that to show that that's the highest point. Our meeting pedal and what we have learned is the highest point. So that is our strength, using the strategies to teach. Then we have challenges. As we taught, using the strategies, we had some challenges. This included infrastructure. Some of our class sizes, no, that is different. So infrastructure, where the even sitting arrangements and then the arrangement in the class does not really favor a teaching approach or a method that we are using. Then we also have technology. You have nice ideas like videos and all that, but you get to class and internet becomes a challenge, or there is power outage, and then that becomes it's likely to end the class abruptly. We also have large classes that it becomes very difficult to do innovative stuff with, but our colleagues tried. And then we have untrained co-lecturers, especially for our colleagues that teach undergraduate students. They are co-lecturers. Sometimes the class sizes are very large, like 1,000. So the students are shared among four lecturers teaching the same syllabus. And then because some of our colleagues are pedal trained and they are bringing in all these innovations, our on-pedal trained colleagues have a problem with, for instance, coming to a class and showing a video to engender discussion. They think you just came to entertain and you are going away. And sometimes we have had occasion where somebody had marked a colleague down because he didn't understand the teaching approach. So that is one difficulty we have. And we also think the students are shortchanged because those who come to the pedal train classes gain more and then those who go to the other classes. So there is not a balance in the delivery to students because of the number of people that are on this training. We also have so this is on the part of colleague lecturers. On the part of students, they are used to lectures. I come, there are slides, I take notes and I go away. They are not used to the innovation, so the shift is becoming a problem and they are not responding too well. So like the example I cited, some of them would prefer to run to the classes where they get the lectures rather than stay in our class where we stimulate them with these different activities. So the response to the new innovation, the shift in teaching, is a problem. Students are not responding well, and we have to do something about it. Overcoming some of these challenges we have identified, we realize that planning with multiple approaches. So instead of just planning with a video or planning to show something that hinges on power, I would want to do a video, and I also want to have some debates or role plays in mind so that when I go and power fails, I can use the other approach. So that's one of the ways. And then linking innovation. So we realize that we have concentrated on teaching, innovation in teaching, but that has not translated into assessment. And that was a challenge for one of our colleagues. So we have told ourselves that as part of overcoming that and lesson learned is to link the innovation in teaching to innovation in assessment. So we are not found wanting in that regard. And also prepare assessment as part of, yes, innovation and assessment. Prepare it concurrently with teaching. So as I prepare innovations in teaching, I do it concurrently with assessment. And then more time is needed. We need more time. So we have one of our colleagues who sent students to an organization, different organizations, to collect data before the start of the semester, to use for the semester. But because some of the organizations were not receptive, and this delayed how she intended to use the approach. So this time she has planned, she's going to prepare more and look for organizations that are more familiar or will be more receptive, so it won't hinder or hamper the progress of that approach. So those were some of our challenges. As we said, our strategies are bigger, challenges are, you know, just to show that we are doing well.
Yeah.
And we also have feedback based on all of this. We had some feedback for PASGA. We thought that even though some of our challenges are very individual based, like large class sizes, infrastructure that PASGA can't pedal, may not have enough control over because it's an university-based problem. We also think that PEDAL should also maybe link with partner invest, because what would be the point in teaching us all these innovations and we go back and things like infrastructure is not helping us to practice them. So we know it would be a big, a Herculean task to ask PEDAL to build infrastructure, but could they at least partner with the universities to get their buy-in so that things like infrastructure and other things that create an enabling environment for us to use the modules will be made available. Otherwise, it will be a cost 90 for most of us. We also said that the training modules, we have realized from the different training sessions from Nairobi to Ibadan to this place that we are overloaded. And there are a lot of adult learners amongst us. Most of us are adult learners. The overloading is not helpful. But far above that, we think that some of these things should be university or needs-based, so that partner universities should tell PEDAL where our deficiencies are and where we would need their training. In that case, there wouldn't be the overload or the need to give us everything in one go. We think we have to reduce the load we put on the participants by knowing what we need. For instance, at the University of Ghana, we have what we call Sakai. It's almost like an enhanced, technology-enhanced training. So we won't buy into what PEDAL is offering easily because the university will think it's a duplication of effort. Yet there are many things PEDAL is offering that we are deficient in that our university will readily accept. We think doing a need-based training model for universities will be more useful. We like this, but for better results, this will help. We also think that there is contradiction in PEDAL training, and this was very unanimous. Because pedal training says that there are diverse learners. And so when we go back, we should pay attention to the diversity and deliver accordingly. But we realize in these trainings that the diversity amongst us, I mean, do we even know how diverse this group is? What are our learning needs? How are we absorbing all of these things? We don't see that translate in the training. So we think that in a very mild and light note, practicing what you preach could be useful here. So the contradiction has to be taken care of, because if we are rushed in many things and you say we should go back and take our time, that becomes like holding the chin and pointing to the cheek. So that has to be paid attention to. We also mentioned that there is the need to build cascade pedal in other universities. An example is what happened in Ibadan. If we could replicate it in other places, so that the issue of co-lecturers not being pedal trained and its accompanying challenges might be taken care of. So those are the feedback. As we said, that is also a very small box, fading almost in comparison with our strategies. I am our double deck coach for the strategy. We want to say that all in all, pedal is a welcoming idea. So as you can see, we have balloons, we have hip hip hooray, and what we are saying is that pedal is super, pedal is evergreen, and pedal rocks. We are happy about pedal, and we hope our feedback will be taken. Thank you.
Krabala. There is Kampala indeed. I was just trying to identify. First of all, thank you very much for your very impressive reflection. Just to encourage you regarding the student kind of initial resistance, I think whenever there is many of our students across most of our universities have been socialized that everything is done for them. So normally when you begin to get them out of their comfort zone, initially, for most of us, we had that resistance. Some of us were even reported that in this other group, they are given handouts. This one, they leave everything to us. But I can assure you that by the end of the semester, these students keep comparing notes. They will appreciate it. So like the test is in the pudding. So just as a form of encouragement, that initially it has happened almost all the people that to us, if you go around the table and you check, this is something that is normally resisted, both by the students, but also for the students to be able to have that form of control. It means more work even for us. So colleagues will also resist it, because you need to really plan. But at the end of it, you realize that when you do the prior planning well, then in class, things are a lot easier and thereafter. So that was just a form of encouragement.
Thank you.
Let's keep it going.
Thank you
for that encouragement to all of us. I invite the next team.
So we still have two wonderful academics from the University of Ghana, and we want to interview them. They are going to tell us what their take homes have been, and also their aha moment throughout the annual convening. And so, Prof, my name is Kwesi.